God is doing amazing things in your relationship. And you're a part of this as you continue to be so faithful and generous in your work. We encourage you to keep doing what you're doing on our website or just
it really is amazing how God is doing this. And we know that our life groups can be a huge blessing in our church. We don't want you to do life groups. Our life groups are running different ways. We have many options to choose from. We have interest groups, student groups, talking groups, play groups that are made in prison, play groups that are made in the home of so go on our website, Four Generation Church Path.
You can tune it out.
We love our life groups. We can't hear it enough.
It won't be in the house.
This is an incredible group that supports and encourages each other in the journey of life. If you have any hearts, habits, or dreams, we would love for you to join us in Mesa on Tuesday or an opportunity on Friday night. You can just show up and you can go on our life groups and sign up.
If you would like to learn more about our church,
I saw your daughter, but I wondered for you. Are you ready to worship today, church? Let's get your hands ready. Here we go.
Worthy of all the praise.
him praise. Give him praise. Take a moment and press in. Give him praise, church. God is good, amen? And he is worthy to be praised. You know, church, the Bible says, when we praise him with singing and loud drums and stringed instruments, the Lord looks down from heaven and he smiles. Amen. I'm paraphrasing, of course, but he loves to worship. Let's pray. Father, you are good. You are so good today, Father. We worship you today. We are so grateful we can come and sing praise to your name. Lord, now our hearts are ready. We need a word from you. It's been a week. Lord, fill us by your Spirit. Teach us through your word and bless Pastor Randy as he comes. Bless your servant today. In Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Then we talked about biblical marriage, how to have a biblical marriage, Then we talked about Family Feud, families fight. Have you noticed that? But we want you to fight for your family, not against it.
That's right, come on.
Then we looked at you can't fix your kids, as much as we would love to, as much as we wish we could, you can't. And then last week we talked about honoring the family, how we need to have honor up, down, and all around. So this morning, as we finish up the series, we're going to talk about living your legacy, or leaving a legacy. As we believers, we have an obligation to leave behind a legacy. We benefited from the commitment of those who came before us. Thank God for them.
Yeah.
And we need to be mindful of those who come after us. And first, we got to realize that building a legacy means we are called to leave a legacy. And Proverbs 13:22 says, a good man leaves an inheritance for his children, but a sinner's wealth is stored up for the righteous. Now, here's a harsh truth of life, and you probably know this, but nobody's getting any younger. And if you are getting older, you're not alone.
Yeah.
Much of America is actually an aging population. I don't know if you knew this, but every 6 seconds a person in our country turns 50. 43% of our population is over 50. By 2030, which is 10 years from now, the over 85 population in our country is going to double. And right now, the over 85 population is the fastest growing population in our country. So now if you are in an older age group, however you define yourself, if you are in an older age group, all I have to say to you is, congratulations! Yeah, you made it! You are a survivor! Life is dangerous. Nature's out to get you. There's lions and tigers and bears. Oh my! But if that doesn't get you, those tiny little viruses can get you. You dodged a lot of bullets to get this far. Cemeteries are full of people who didn't get to live as long as you got to live. So it is a tremendous blessing and privilege to live a long life, and we should be thankful for that. But on the flip side of that, we have a duty, we have a responsibility to the next generation. We need to look to the future no matter what our age. It's like one time a young man was talking to an older gentleman, and he said, sir, what are your plans for the future? And the old man said, son, at my age, I don't even buy green bananas. Some of you are just getting that, right? Oh, green bananas, yeah. No matter what our age, we do need to think about the future and plan on our legacy. Now, by legacy, a legacy is what we pass down to the next generation. To our children, to our grandchildren, to our great-grandchildren. Now, you may not be able to leave them a lot of money or property or possessions, but God has called us to leave a godly legacy. And what a difference it can make. You know, they did a study of two families, of two men who lived about the same time, one whose name was Max Jukes. And Max was known as a wicked, ungodly man. He was an atheist. And they studied his family tree. And his family tree had 709 descendants. And out of that, 280 of them died paupers. 140 of them wound up in jail. 60 were thieves. 6 were murderers. 128 were prostitutes. And 300 of them died at an early age due to bad behavior and bad choices. And they cost society a lot of money. The other person they studied was a guy named Jonathan Edwards. Jonathan Edwards was a preacher. He was instrumental in leading the First Great Awakening in the colonies. And
his family tree consisted of 1,394 descendants. And out of that, 100 were lawyers, 13 college professors, 100 are college presidents, 100 were college professors, 62 were doctors, 100 were clergymen, 80 were elected to public office, 3 of them were mayors, 3 of them were governors, 7 of them were congressmen, 3 of them were senators, and 1 was a vice president. 60 were authors who wrote 135 books, and 75 served in the Army and Navy as officers. What a difference in a family tree, right? What you do, how you live, is going to live on long after you and I are gone. They asked a number of centenarians, those are people over 100 centenarians. They asked them, what was your greatest regret? You know what the number one greatest regret was? I wish I could leave behind something that lives on beyond me. In other words, a legacy. Now the good news is we still have the opportunity. We can still do that. So what you and I need to do is start by building a godly legacy. How do we do that? What do we need to do? Well, first of all, building a godly legacy means to live a life of godly character. Proverbs 22 verse 1 says, a good name is more desirable than great riches. To be esteemed is better than silver or gold. I like how the Amplified puts this. It says, a good name earned by honorable behavior, godly wisdom, moral courage, personal integrity. In other words, character.
Yeah.
Godly character. Now, a good reputation, to have a good reputation, that's a good thing. It's good to have a good reputation. We should want a good reputation. But character goes even deeper than reputation. If you look at reputation versus character, reputation is what you live up to, but character is what you are. Reputation precedes you.
So your reputation has preceded you, right?
But character remains when you're gone. Reputation is momentary. You can get a reputation pretty quick, but character is built over a lifetime. Reputation is what men say at your funeral, but character is what's said about you around the throne of God. Reputation is who men think you are, but character is who God knows who you are. And we want our character and conduct to reflect Christ. In 2 Peter 1, 5-9, it says, for this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measures, this is something you should grow in, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But if anyone does not have them, he's nearsighted and blind, he has forgotten that he has been cleansed from his past sins. So godly character is so important. Ephesians 4:1 says, as a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Godly character. Our goal and our desire in this life should be to live a life of godly character. We want to pass that on to the next generation. Secondly, we want to pass on is to stand up for what you believe. 6 times in the New Testament they use the term stand, stand firm, stand fast, stand. 1 Corinthians 16 verse 13 it says, be on your guard, stand firm in the faith, be men of courage, be strong. Now to understand that, it helps to understand how ancient warfare worked in those times. In ancient warfare, basically your army would line up, and the opposing army would line up, and you would basically march together towards each other. And you would be wearing armor, and you'd have a big shield in front of you, and they would be wearing armor, and they would have big shields. So these two lines would kind of clash together. It's not like in the movies where everybody's fighting everybody. It's more like line on line. And there would be even lines behind them. And so basically, You had this big shield. You were in armor. They had that, their big shield. They were in armor. So you're trying to find a vulnerable place, reach over your shield or stab through their shield. In other words, you didn't really hurt the other guy that much in that type of a situation. It was really more of a pushing contest. You push against them, they push against you. But here's the thing. When the killing really started is when one side got tired or lost their courage and started to run away. When they started to run away, that's when the killing really started. That's when you ran up and stabbed them in the back. That's how they would be slain by the hundreds or the thousands when they ran away, when they did not stand firm. So consequently, when you're in line pushing against the other line, the officers would be yelling, "Stand firm, men! Stand fast! Dig in, hold your ground, refuse to budge, plant yourself, hold steady, stand firm." And we are commanded to stand up for what we believe, for what we know is true. Don't back down.
Yeah.
Don't compromise. Don't give in on what is true. I read the difference between a belief and a conviction is a belief is something you may argue over, but a conviction is something you'll die for.
Yeah.
Our kids, our grandkids will consciously or subconsciously pick up on our convictions. There was a young man who was 11 years old living in Germany at the time. And one day his father came home and said to his son, "We are no longer Jews. We are now Lutherans." Son said, "Why?" He said, "It's better for business." And that son named Carl became so disillusioned by his dad turning his back on his religion for money that he became an atheist. And he wrote a book, maybe I've heard of it, The Communist Manifesto by Karl Marx. And the results of that were millions are going to die and billions are going to be oppressed because lack of conviction. If we don't stand for what we believe, if we don't stand for our convictions, if we don't stand for truth, biblical truth, we fail ourselves, we fail our kids, and we fail our God. And today, in our world today, it's challenging. And I mean, I've seen a lot of Christian parents who are under a lot of pressure not to stand firm for what they believe, or to try to have to compromise on truth. And there have been times when I've seen Christian parents compromise on biblical truth because their children embraced unbiblical lifestyle. See, this happened a number of times. And the parents will say, "Well, we just want our kids to be happy." You know, you can't change the Word of God just to accommodate your kids. The Word is the Word. Stand firm on the Word of God. Stand firm on your priorities. Stand firm on what's right. Stand up for the truth. Stand up for God. Stand up for what you know is right. And that is getting increasingly hard in our society because we're getting more and more pressure to come under to the thinking of the world. And that's why it takes courage and strength to stand firm, but that's the legacy you want to live. And then the third thing, in building a godly legacy, passing on a godly legacy, is showing godly love and care. And we see this in Ephesians 6:4. "Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and the instruction of the Lord." Titus 2:4. "Then they can train the young women to love their husbands and children." And in Colossians 3:19, "Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them." Now, the Bible's telling us, love your wives, love your husband, love your kids. We talked about blessing our kids and in previous messages, and we talked about the importance of a meaningful touch, of a loving touch. And I just encourage your parents, touch your children, even if they're fully grown. They still need hugs. They still need touches. say I love you to them. There's something about the spoken word of I love you. Don't just say, well, they know I love them. I should know. They need to hear those words, I love you. Something powerful about that. So say that. Do that. Our family members should never, ever, ever doubt our love for them.
That's right.
Come on. And I heard someone say, how do your kids spell love? T-I-M-E. Time. I like the story of Susanna Wesley, and she had 18 children, 10 of which made it to adulthood, but one of the things she did is she would take time during the week for each one of her children one-on-one. And one night it would be this kid, and next night this kid. Sometimes, you know, there's only 7 days in the week. She had 10 kids, so sometimes she had to double up. But she would take time with her kids, and her son, one of her sons was John Wesley, the great evangelist.
Yep.
And in one of his letters, later on in his life, he wrote home and said, Mother, what I wouldn't give for a Thursday night for some one-on-one time. So take time for your kids. Take time for your kids. In the Greek, there's four types of love. They have four, you know, we just have one word for love. And the English language sometimes is not very precise. Like we would say, yeah, I love pizza, I love White Castle, I love my wife, I love my kids, I love the Cardinals, I don't love the Seahawks, nobody does. But in the Greek language we have there's four words for love. So it's a little more precise. Like there's phileo, which is a brotherly love between good friends. And we see that like with David and Jonathan. That can be a very strong bond. There's also storge love. That's a familial love. That's love for your parents, love for your children, love for your brothers and sisters. Then there's an eros. That's a sensual love, a sexual love, which should go on between a man and wife. But the highest form of love is what's called agape love. That is a God-type love. It transcends human love. It's an unconditional love. It's a love that says, I love you just because I choose to. I love you because it's an unconditional love. No conditions. You don't have to earn it. You don't deserve it. You can't perform to get it. It's I love you. No child should ever feel like they have to earn our love or perform to a certain level to be loved. Now, it's okay to try to challenge them to do good, and that's fine, but they should never, ever feel like they have to earn our love. And no child should ever grow up and say, I never felt like my dad loved me. I never felt like my mom loved me. I never felt like I was good enough. That should never be that. And agape love is a sacrificial love. I will sacrifice for you and your good. Greater love hath no man than he who lays down his life or sacrifices his life for a friend. Being a parent calls for sacrifice, for sacrificial love. You know, they asked one man who built this huge company from scratch, they said, what's the best thing you can do for your employees? And I love his answer. He said, the best thing I can do for my employees is be a cheerleader. And you know what? Our kids, no matter what their age, need us to be a cheerleader. Now, I remember when I was in West Orange High School playing football, and you know, I played on some good teams, and I played on some still real stinkers. And one thing that impressed me were our cheerleaders, in the sense that no matter how the game was going, I mean, we could be down 45-0. And with 2 minutes left on the clock, and they would be there, V-I-C-T-O-R-Y, V-I-C-T-O-R-Y, victory, victory, let time cry. I just wanted to go over and say, ladies, I appreciate it, but we've got about as much chance of winning this game as a snowball in the devil's backyard, okay? But they're there going like, victory, victory. I appreciate their upbeat persistence, right? Be a cheerleader for your kids, especially if it feels like they're losing 45-0. Because they need somebody to cheer them on. They need our love. They need our care. They need our cheerleading, which is really another way of saying encouragement. And then here's the next thing. We need, as a godly legacy, we need to pass on the gospel. Passing on the gospel starts with passing on our faith, our personal faith. We want to leave a legacy of faith to those who come behind us, to benefit from our faith and from our example. If you read Hebrews chapter 11, it is a legacy of people of faith to us. By faith, Abel left a legacy of giving to God. Hebrews 11:4 says, by faith, Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, he still speaks. That's a legacy. By faith, he still speaks even though he is dead. God takes note of our giving. And he pleasures in our giving. And he wants us to be an example of generosity. Noah left a legacy of building projects. It takes a lot of faith to build a boat in a desert many years before it's going to rain. Now, thank God, Noah didn't have to get permits. And that would have been the end of mankind right there. Abraham left a legacy of stepping out in faith and following God, even when you don't know where you're going, even when you can't see the finish line. And you know what? Sometimes, often, following God is a process of step by step. It's a step by step process. God will lead you here, but then from here he'll lead you to here, and then to here, and then to here. And he leads. A lot of times it's a step by step. Rarely does he ever show us the whole timeline, right? Step by step, following God is a process. One step leads to the next step. And sometimes we don't understand why we're going to the next step, but God knows. Sarah leaves us a legacy of believing God even when it looks impossible. Having a baby at 90 looks impossible. But we believe in a God who makes the impossible possible. Isaac left us a legacy of blessing his children. Then we see Jacob blessing his children. He got that from his dad. In Hebrews 11:26, it says, he regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the... I jumped ahead of the wrong scripture. I need to back up. It's Hebrews 11:20. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau in regard to their future. Hey, that makes more sense than it does. But I'll get to other scriptures. Remember how important it is to bless your kids. We talked about that. And you can't fix your kids. There were five blessings. A loving touch. I love you. You are valuable. I see a great future for you. I'm committed to your success. You can't make your kids love God. No matter how much you like to. You can't always fix your kids, but we can all bless our kids. We can bless our children. And then next, Moses leaves us a legacy of forsaking this world for Christ. And see that in 11:26. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt because he was looking ahead to his reward. He forsook all the power, fame, fortune, and pleasure of sin that Egypt had to offer for following God for disgrace for the sake of Christ. He basically forsook the four P's. The four P's are pleasure, I want to feel good, possessions, I want lots of stuff, prestige, I want people to envy me, and power, I want to be in control. Moses said, I don't want that, I want Jesus. And I am looking forward to a better reward. We need to pass on a legacy, personal faith, but we also need to pass on a legacy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We need to pass on our faith to the next generation, but we also need to reach the next generation. And we read in Judges here of a whole generation who grew up who didn't know the Lord or didn't know what he had done. How could that have happened? How is that somehow mom and dad failed to tell their children, failed to tell the next generation, failed to pass on the goodness of God? And it's our job as Christians, it's our job as parents, and it's our job as a church to pass the gospel on to the next generation. And sadly, too many churches have not accepted that challenge. Too many churches have said we'd rather die and close our doors than change. We'd rather be comfortable than to reach people for Christ. Generation Church is committed to reach people. We are committed to reach all generations with the good news. And we will do whatever it takes. You know, one of our values as a church is whatever it takes to reach the next generation, to pass on our faith, and to prepare them to pass on their faith to the next generation. I am so thankful to those who came ahead and made it possible for me to hear the gospel, for me to be saved, and for me to have a church where I could grow in my faith. So thankful for. You know, there's an old legend that goes like this. Jesus ascends into heaven, and Gabriel asks him, "Lord, what plans have you made for carrying on your ministry in the world? How will people learn of what you've done for them?" And Jesus said, "Well, I left that to Peter, James, John, Martha, and Mary. They're to tell their friends, and their friends will tell their friends, and to the whole world has heard the good news." But then Gabriel asks, "Well, what if Peter is too busy with his nets? And what if Martha is so full of her housework, and all those others get so preoccupied they forget to tell their friends? Don't you think you should have some other plans?" And Jesus said, "I've made no other plan. I'm counting on my children to spread my name." Now, I like to remind us that the gospel is not the best hope for the world. It's the only hope for the world. Amen. There is no plan B. And it's our job and it's our responsibility to get the good news out to our local community and to around the world. And as far as legacy goes, here's something to think about. As far as legacy goes, maybe you should consider your will. You know, one way to leave a legacy is remembering the work of the Lord in your will. Now, you may want to leave a part or all of your estate to the church or to God's work. Like Proverbs 13:22, remember, it says a godly man leaves an inheritance, and it's good and godly to leave an inheritance to your family, to leave an inheritance to our family members, especially if they're godly. If my inheritance was I would not subsidize my children's sin with my money. Amen? I just would not do that. If they're living sinful lives, forget it. But otherwise, it's good to leave an inheritance. But it's also good to leave an inheritance to our spiritual family so that the work of God can go forward. Remember a few years ago, we at our church, we had a man who was in his middle age, died unexpectedly. He had no relatives, and he left his estate to Generation Church. Yeah. And his estate came to like over $300,000. So it was fairly substantial. And out of that, you know, part of that legacy is Generation Church was one year the fastest growing church in Arizona. For 3 or 4 years now, we've been in the top 100 fastest growing churches in the nation. And you know what's good about leaving your estate or your property or your money to the work of God after you go to heaven? You know what's good about that? You're dead, so you won't miss a penny of it. Number two, you don't need it anymore, right? I mean, I know sometimes you're like, well, I'd like to give this, but what if I needed it? You don't have that struggle anymore. And here's best of all, number three, best of all, while you're in heaven and enjoying heaven, your money is down here doing the work of the Lord.
Yeah.
So you're racking up rewards while you're in heaven. It's like a win-win, right? So that's something to consider. John Maxwell said, achievement comes to someone when he's able to do great things for himself. Success is when he empowers his followers to do great things with him. But legacy is when a person puts his organization in a place to do great things without him. They carry on and on and on. So just as we close, no matter how wealthy you are or how poor you are, we can all leave a godly legacy. You know, I think of my wife, Dawn, and her grandfather came over from Germany, Johann, and as a young man, he came to America, and he got invited to a Pentecostal church where Johann got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. And he raised his four sons to love the Lord, one of which was my wife's dad, who raised my wife, Dawn, and her brother and sister to love the Lord. And she married me. I was first generation salvation. But now we're raising our children. We've raised our children to love the Lord. And now we're in the process, they're in the process of raising their kids, my great-grandkids, to love the Lord. Five generations, all because of one decision. One man decided, I am gonna give my life to Jesus. And it's carried on now for five generations. That's a legacy. Here's something to think about. You know, life comes down to, if you boil life down to what's important, I think it basically comes down to what we leave and what we take. What we leave and what we take. The only thing we really leave behind when we die is a legacy. What lives on after us? What carries on when we're gone? That's a legacy. But also what's important is what we take when we go into eternity. You know what you take? The only thing we take is our eternal soul. We will spend eternity either in heaven with Jesus or in hell away from God. So the only thing we're taking is our soul and where we spend eternity. We'll leave a legacy and we take our soul. So just as we bow our heads this morning, close our eyes, I want to ask you, what kind of a legacy are you leaving? Are you leaving a godly legacy? Well, you know what? It's never too late to start. As long as you're still here, you can leave a legacy. That's the good news. But also, I want to ask you, well, what are you taking when you go into eternity? Do you know for sure that when you go into eternity, you're going to be welcomed into heaven? I can't think of anything worse than going into eternity and finding I am not welcomed into heaven. That would not be a good thing. That would be something you'd regret for all eternity. So how can I be welcomed into heaven? Well, if you give enough money, no, it doesn't take that. Well, if I do enough good works, no, you can't do enough good works. Well, if I try to be a good person, no, you can't be good enough. There's only one way you can be welcomed into heaven, and that is by the grace of God. By saying, Jesus, I am a sinner. I need your grace. Forgive my sins. I recognize the work you did for me on the cross. That's how you're welcomed into heaven. And if you're here this morning, if you've never done that, if you've never said, Jesus, I need your grace, I need your forgiveness, if you've never done that, or maybe you did at one time in your life, but you've gotten away from it, you want to come back to that this morning, if that's your desire, just as we're praying and heads are bowed, we just want to pray with you. I'm just going to ask you, if that's your desire, just put your hand up and say, Pastor, would you pray for me? I want to receive Christ as my Savior. God bless you. Thank you. Father, I just thank you, God, for those that raise their hand, Lord, that you would just help us to know you and grow in you, Father. And I just want to pray for those, God, those of us who need to leave a legacy, who are in the process of leaving a godly legacy. God, help us to do that. It's our job to reach the next generation, God. Help us to do that in our family and in our world. We want to reach the next generation. And we pray that you would help us to do that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you this morning, and we just want to remind you that next week we're going to be doing one-on-one class after our service here. If one-on-one class is over in the other building, that's where, if you're interested in our church and becoming a member of our church or getting involved in the ministry of our church, that's the next step, is one-on-one class. So you might want to plan on coming to church and going to one-on-one if you haven't done that yet. We want you to get involved. Even if you're only here for a season, get involved in church. Be used of God. Amen?
Amen.
Also, for offering, we're not taking up an offering because of our situation in our world today, but we do have offering boxes in the back, or you can give online. If you have a Connect card, go to the Connect table, and somebody will meet you there and hand them your Connect card, and we'll give you a gift. So let's stand together, and may the Lord bless you as you go this morning, and may he shine his face upon you. Go with God and be blessed. Enjoy one another. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yes. Yeah.